Welcome to Speechless. We're glad to have you here live from the SCC studios in White Bear Lake and also playing live over SPNN in St. Paul. It's replays later in various other communities, and we're glad to have you here. It's a live call-in talk show, so if you have comments or questions, please feel free to call in at 651-747-3838. If you want to watch some past shows, go to youtube.com/speechlessmn. And if you want to give comments or suggestions on the show but you don't want to call in, email me at speechlessmn@gmail.com. And I think we have a very, very fascinating show today. People from Maplewood, you're going to want to listen. She's going to talk about Maplewood. Diana Longry's going to be with me, who's running for city council, past mayor of Maplewood. And she's running for the city council seat this time around. And you're just going to get a whole lot of information about Maplewood. But it applies to your cities, too. So even if you don't live in Maplewood, it's going to be a lot about how cities govern and how, in my opinion, your liberties are being taken away. So watch the show. That's what we're going to talk about. But before we get into that, a huge issue in the city of Grant. I mean, this is monumental. This is important for the city of Grant. If you're a citizen there and can vote, you need to vote October 13th. And I recommend you vote for the city charter that's on the ballot. City charter is like a constitution. It lays down some ground rules in which the officials of the city and how they need to behave. So not only are you establishing Robert's Rules of Order, you're establishing the type of community you're going to have and the type of voting process that will take place. And it's really, really important that you're there. A lot is happening in Grant, and you need to be aware of that. The city council, in my opinion, is not following the law, not following Robert's Rules of Order, even though they say that's the rules they follow. They're not doing it, in my opinion. And this charter commission will put a check and balance over all the city council members. So, and it will help you as a citizen out. The voting will take place October 13th at Oak Hill Lutheran Church. That's where the polling place is for the city of Grant, has been for quite a while. That's on Highway 36, just east of Hilton Trail, about 6 or 8 blocks. And also, you can vote absentee ballot. And you need to go to Washington County, the courthouse there, and pick up your ballot there for that election. So that's coming up October 13th, City of Grant. You need to vote. But there's another issue coming up here in the voting. I think it's the first Tuesday after the first Monday in November. There's an election. And so we have Diana Longry running for City Council of Maplewood coming on the show. Well, thank you, Diana, for being on the show.
My pleasure.
you have quite a history in Maplewood, not a long one compared to others.
That's true.
But you are the past mayor.
Yes, actually, I was the first woman mayor, and that was a challenge in and of itself because that really challenged some of the paradigms that were in existence in Maplewood at that time. And they held the direction that we went to a different standard than how they held other councils.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the most positive directions that I am very proud of is that we established in the citizens' mind in Maplewood that their parks and neighborhood preserves could be sold at any time and that they need to have permanent protections. Mm-hmm. That it's not just a given that you think that you've got a park or you've got a preserve down the street from you, that because it's owned by the city of Maplewood, that it's going to be there and available for all future generations, because that is not just so. And we went into that, we fleshed that out, and we started an initiative to permanently protect some of our green spaces, and while I was there, we were able to do so for the Priory Preserve. And then the initiative was dropped, and it's something that I think we should always remember that we have to protect.
Well, that's a key point, because when the citizens, and I see this happening in Maplewood, the citizens have risen up, have spoken, said they want things a certain way, but then a new council comes in and then they just ignore the citizens. The people of that local area, whether it's Gladstone or these park areas, they then go and go against it, the people that live in that area.
That's right.
And so, you know, you as a citizen, just because something, you prevent something from happening once, doesn't mean they're not going to do it again or try a different way or, you know, you got to be vigilant.
you certainly do, because with every change of a council, you can have a change of policy. And keep in mind, Maplewood is what's called a Plan B city. Mm-hmm. And that means that the city manager is the one that runs the day-to-day activity up at City Hall. And they, of course, are managed by the city council. But if you have a city council that doesn't really actively see their role as managing the city manager, that they want to be old buddies with the city manager, or that they are just, you know, it's a part-time council. And so they may see their role as simply that of, well, they come to a meeting twice a month, they read their proposals, and then they just vote. Well,
right.
It's actually, if you do the job right, it's much more involved in that, and it takes much more time
right.
than that. You really... that was one thing that I discovered when I was on the council before, the amount of commitment that it takes if you want to do the job right for the residents of Maplewood.
Well, I mean, isn't the staff just going to tell you the truth and what they need and lay out all the details so that you have all the information? They do that?
In an ideal world, yes.
Okay.
In an ideal world. But you still, as an elected official, you have to read the materials that are provided to you, and you have to ask questions. You have to think to yourself, well, what I'm reading here is inconsistent with another policy that we've created somewhere else. And see, the council, they're policymakers. And so it's up to them to think, what is the policy that's right for our community? Sure, maybe the community down the road did this, mm-hmm. but that doesn't necessarily mean that it's the right policy for our community.
Right.
And you will only know what the right policy is for your community if you get out
right.
and actually talk to your residents.
Well, you're involved in a system, because it's Class B, of checks and balances over the government.
Mm-hmm.
And so all these employees that Maplewood have, a majority of them, especially in the high salary positions, or I don't want to say leadership, but the commission, you know, they're head of departments.
Sure.
They don't live in Maplewood.
For the most part, that's correct. They do not.
So it's the city council and mayor's job to protect the Maplewood citizens mm-hmm. rather
right.
than to see that these department heads get their goals and objectives.
Right, and you know, I'm glad that you talked about that a little bit, because see, I see, when I was on the council before, I saw my role in many ways differently than I think a lot of council members currently or in the past saw their role. That they saw their role, and today, as in the past, they saw their role as being the barrier between the residents of the community mm-hmm. and City Hall, and that their duty is to protect City Hall and
right.
defend City Hall, because now they are the elected officials. And see, I always saw
yeah.
my role very differently than that. I saw my role as representing the residents of the community, in that since they got me there,
right,
that I'm the one to help them get their foot in the door of City Hall so that they can get into City Hall and be a part of what we do. Mm-hmm. And that's a very different perception.
Very different.
Of what your purpose is as an elected official.
Right.
My purpose has always been to have citizen engagement, of getting folks involved, of helping them understand how to better utilize their City Hall, how to use the processes, how to use those processes so that they can help create the policy for their own community. Mm-hmm. Because I can't do it all. I
right.
need their help.
Right.
And they live there with me. So that's the way I've always looked at
well,
it.
You know, and then I've given you the nickname Mrs. Transparency.
You know?
So that fits in definitely with what you
that.
Do. Well, you are. We have a caller on the line. So, caller, do you have a comment or question?
No, how are you doing, Tim, and how are you doing, Diana?
Doing well.
My question to you, Diana, is a hypothetical situation with the League of Minnesota Cities. As we all know, Maplewood has been in a lot of turmoil, a lot of legal action being taken against employees, even former employees. Is there such a situation where the League of Minnesota Cities says, you know what, the city of Maplewood needs to be totally restructured as far as releasing current employees and basically starting the city over? Has that ever happened, or is that something that's even feasible for doing? Thank you.
Wow.
Well, that is a power-packed question.
It sure is.
Because first of all, is that there is this perception out there that there was a period of time a few years back that there was a lot of litigation, and that the League of Minnesota Cities, for whatever reason, was unhappy with the city of Maplewood. Well, because I was not confident in their statistics, I actually asked for data from the League of Minnesota Cities to determine what was the incidence of litigation prior to this time that they're complaining about, during the time that they're complaining about, and then, of course, I haven't done it again to know about afterwards, but I can tell you that during that set of data that I looked at, there were large numbers of litigation that the mainstream media never even
just
paid attention
didn't talk
to.
About.
But they wanted to pay attention to litigation while I was on the council because it made good headlines, because it made turmoil, because it made agitation, and so that way, quite frankly, they could say, well, look at how bad this council is, when in fact the newspapers and the media should have done their job, I hate to say it, but done their investigation and said, well, let's take a look at what has been the litigation in the past.
Right.
And now currently they could say, what has the litigation been since then? Because quite frankly, the litigation costs associated with Patty Guerin and the Wipers case that was settled during Will Rosbach's term as mayor, mm-hmm, is every bit as large or larger,
right,
than adding all the litigation that was headline material during my term. Add all that together, it's about the same as the Wipers case, which was during Will Rosbach's term,
yeah,
and nobody faulted
them. Press didn't cover
them.
That. Are you
no.
saying that the press isn't on your side?
You know,
are they being biased in their coverage of you?
Well, there have been some good articles.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, there will be. I will say that there have been some good articles, but the fact of the matter is that it depends on the winds of politics. When you're not in power and they think that they want to do a little c'est la vie piece, well, then it's nice and it's fluff and it's wonderful.
Mm-hmm.
But when suddenly they think, you know, you might be in a position where somebody may listen to what you have to say and that they don't like what you have to say, because I don't really mince my words.
Right.
I mean, I'm not brash about my thinking, but I'm also common sense about what I'm thinking about, and I'm not going to put it in pudding talk so that it sounds like, well, we're just talking pudding.
And Mayor Rossbach said that you're the most knowledgeable, researched person that's ever been on that city council.
You know, he did.
I mean, he just said, you do your research, you do your studying, you know.
And he did do that. And also during the council, one of the council meetings when they were deciding whether or not I should be authorized to represent the city at the National League of Cities Conference. Initially, he was going to vote against it. In the end, he voted for it because he said if there was anyone who was going to be able to go to Washington, D.C. to go to this conference and figure out how to turn that into jobs for Maplewood, it would be Diana.
Right.
And so, you know, I take that as a great compliment because we did not always get along, you know, there were some highlights.
I think a problem the League of Minnesota City had was they're not used to dealing with people that could read legal documents and understand what's going on and challenge them on what they're doing.
Right, and see, and that's the thing that most residents don't really understand, and I think most
background stuff.
Yeah,
you don't see
and
that.
And city council members, I don't think they understand this either, is that they think that the insurance company is there to defend the city's position. In reality, because they're the insurance company, they're really looking out after their bottom line because they're the insurance company.
Right.
See, so when I first started, I didn't actually realize that. I should have realized it, but it wasn't until we got into a case where, you know, the council wanted to go in one direction, but the league said, no, you can't go in that direction. Even though you think you're going to win, you can't go in that direction because since we're the insurance company and we're defending it, you must go in this direction and you must settle whether you want to or not. And then you get the big headlines that says, oh, they settle for this sum of money.
Right.
Well, it wasn't because that was our choice. We basically were told we had to, even though we had legal representation indicating that we possibly had a good chance of winning.
And so since the legal representation, which League of Minnesota Cities, is looking out for their bottom line and not Maplewood's, they're in a position where they could not tell you, they might not tell you what your legal options are ahead of time so that you as a city can act.
Because certainly I will tell you that in one of our cases when we wanted to go in a different direction than the league did because we believed that we would win the case, and the league said, no, you're not going to do that, you're going to settle. And I said, I asked the representative that we were working with from the league, you know, why is this that the council can't, you know, as a body, make this decision about how to proceed with this case? He said, well, if you had wanted to do that, you would have had to, months ago, give notice to us under clause number such and such and such and such to say that you are going to go and you're going to get your own attorney and that you're not going to be using the league to defend this claim.
Yeah.
And I'm like, okay, well, so bad, so sad.
Yeah.
I didn't think that was how that kind of representation worked from all of the information that I had.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, 2020 is hindsight.
Yeah.
But now I know that, see, and I bet you our current council members, maybe they know this kind of thing, maybe they don't. I'm not sure.
Right. Well, I don't think they do. I could be wrong, but I don't see any type of behavior that way. Well, one of the big lawsuits going on right now with the League of Minnesota Cities was the employee named Larry Farr, who just got a settlement of around $118,000.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, the paper brought out the settlement that he wins the settlement. They didn't bring out tying that into the FBI investigation that's going into the former city manager, Chuck Gall.
Right.
And I think if the caller that just called last, or the first caller too, that's part of the League of Minnesota Cities, could be part of their concern about Maplewood, if they have a concern.
Right. Well, and the caller asked the question, well, you know, does the league, you know, offer any suggestion about whether a city should be reorganized or anything? I don't think so. I've never heard of that, because keep in mind, they're an insurance company and they're worried about their actuarial tables, and the bottom line is really what it is. And so when they're down at the legislature lobbying for certain policies to be enacted by the state legislature, that's from their perspective of how to make less litigation in municipal law, so that they don't have so many claims they have to cover.
Right.
It's not about what's best for the communities. It's not what's best for the residents. It's not what's best for the elected officials, for the city themselves.
Right.
It's really what is going to produce less litigation so that they have less to defend. I mean, that's my opinion. And from what I've seen, what they lobby on, you can tie a direct connection to that.
Well, and go to their website and start reading it. League of Minnesota Cities. You see, it's not about the cities, it's about the league.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, we got another caller here. Oh, caller, okay. You have a comment or question?
Tim Kinley.
Yes.
Mayor Longgreen. And on this issue of transparency, transparency was a major focus when you were mayor. You put all the meetings on cable. You made them accessible. You enlarged the mayor's forum. You had comments that were not limited, that visitors, public input. You had public hearings that were done correctly. Will Rossbach, you know, he pulled back somewhat and became somewhat less transparent. He shut down people. He screamed at people. He intimidated people. He bullied people. And now under our new regime of Norris Baldwin, they basically shut down everything. You can't ask her a question. I don't know how you would ever ask her a question, her opinion on anything. She has a wall completely around her. She's pretty much cut off public presentation. You do have the opportunity, but she interrupts you. She belittles you. She degrades you. She defames you. That's just her motive.
All right, caller.
And my question is that.
I thought you asked one.
My question is, how could you return more transparency to Maplewood when you've got the current mayor who, you know, so intransparent? Many people, they believe that she's actually moved on in her life and doesn't even live in the city of Maplewood, much less, and she doesn't want to take any questions. She doesn't want to comment of even where she lives, much less city policy. Mm-hmm. So how could you ever make it more transparent if you were on the council? Thank you.
So, well, it sounds like you're giving some new information. I'd have to delve in that at some other time as to where she lives. So that's an implication. She's not living in the city. But transparency.
Right.
Communication with the public.
Mm-hmm.
How would you change things?
Right. Well, I've actually had a number of residents that I've talked to ask me that. They'd say, well, you would be in the minority. And I said, well, that's okay. I'm fine with being in the minority. I've been in the minority before. And the responsibility and duty of somebody who's on and in the minority is to speak out and be the voice for the people that aren't being heard. That's the point. It isn't the point of somebody who's in the minority to say, oh, I'm in the minority, I'm going to shrug my shoulders and wait until the council changes. No, the time for action is now. There's ways that, I mean, the council policy and procedure manual says that they use the Roberts Rules of Order. There's a way that you can use Roberts Rules of Order to bring things up. There's, you know, if you think about how to strategically approach this, I think a council member who is in the minority can still make a great impact to help the other council members realize the detrimental actions that they're taking to limiting citizen engagement.
Right. Definitely. Well, somebody text in another question, then we're going to go to the call. The first caller was talking about changing the city government. Grant put together a charter, and they're going to vote on it October 13th here. Should Maplewood have a charter? Would that be something you would pursue, or
You know, that is, I love that question, because you see, this question originally came up, I think, back in 2003 when Emil Sturzenegger came before the city council when Bob Cardinal was the mayor, and he said, wouldn't it be nice if we could separate Maplewood into wards so that representation could be from the various wards because of our shape? And that's what got the conversation started, because then the council and the city staff did some research, and they determined that the only way to do that is that we'd have to change from a Plan B city to a charter city, where then you could establish wards. And there are pros and cons to having wards rather than as we are right now, we're at large. But I do support the concept of having a charter. I think that it gives the residents of the community some kind of checks and balances over their elected officials, either in the policies that they create or the policies they don't create. Or let's say, for instance, if you've got an elected official who you feel is not representative of the community for the specific reasons that are outlined in that charter, the citizens actually would have the right to recall. And currently, if you don't have a charter in a municipality, there's no state right under the statutes for recall.
Okay.
And so, you know, I mean, there are benefits to citizens to have a charter.
All right. Caller, you have a comment or question?
Maybe both.
Okay.
Two issues. First of all, I'd like Diana to talk about what Maplewood is doing in terms of dropping out of the Ramsey Washington Cable Commission and the harm that that's going to do. And I also would, you know, I do appreciate the good people of Grant realizing that voting for a charter is the closest you can get to a true, pure democracy, even though, you know, some people love this republic form of government. But in that case, you know, you can only throw them out after they've done the harm, and especially if they've entered into contracts, you can't undo the contracts, even though you can get rid of the bums. So there is that issue, but there's also your conversation about reorganizing made me think about a city down in Arizona where the whole city is actually contracted out. They only have one official, and in the case of Maplewood, Ramsey County would do the police. They would hire out the fire. They would, everything, public works, everything would be contracted, and then there isn't this problem with people like Sherry Lay suing the city for, you know, tens of hundreds of thousands of dollars and all the things that the unionization of public employees that already have the protection of civil service. And, you know, I look at the fact that when you have supervisors that are in the management position unionizing, how that ties up the city council, the elected people that are there to run the city. So there's so many problems, but I'd like the candidate to talk about some of these issues. Thank you.
Well, I forgot the first question that went on so long. Do you remember it?
I do indeed. And that was about the Ramsey County
joint
powers agreement for the
Cable Commission. Right.
And this is an issue that is going to be occurring before the election. It's going to be happening Monday evening at the City Council meeting, October 12th. And they have on their agenda, they have the resolution to pull out of the joint powers agreement that they have been in for over 20 years with all the other communities that are part of this joint powers agreement that allows for these studios here.
Right. So this show, you're seeing it, is because of this joint powers agreement.
Mm-hmm.
The cable, the cities get together and work it through a contract, and so that all these cities pulling their resources can get a better show, better information, better,
It's a pooling
equipment.
It's a pooling of resources.
Equipment, so talent.
Right. Yeah. So there's not a duplication of efforts because you see, quite a long time ago, the federal legislation was put in place that basically created these channels that the public can use, and so everybody who subscribes to Comcast cable, they have on their little statement of the franchise fee that they pay every month. And you see then that franchise fee goes into, well, in this case, into the kitty for the Joint Powers Coalition of Communities. And then they, based upon the population of that community, they that has a basis of what their vote will be on that commission. So Maplewood being the one of the largest, if not the largest, member on this joint powers in this joint powers agreement,
about 30%.
On this commission, you know, they have a huge voting block, much larger than like Birchwood, for instance.
Right.
You know,
or Willerney.
That's exactly right. But you see, it's working in cooperation with the other communities. And what Maplewood wants is that they want to pull out so that they can get all the franchise money for themselves, so they don't have to contribute to this joint powers agreement. Now, and of course, what is the impact of this? The impact is that all the other smaller communities that are part of the joint powers agreement are going to be left in the lurch and will not be able to provide the same kind of resources with this studio as they could have when Maplewood was with them. And the other thing that I found so ironic about this, and I just want to mention this, that I've just got done going through all these different organizations that are talking about whether or not they want to endorse you or not, right?
Right.
And half of them have a question on their questionnaire about how do you feel about joint powers agreement and about working together with your neighboring communities to regionalize this service or this other initiative, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I tell them, well, of course, that makes for efficiency. It only makes common sense. I support joint powers agreement. And by the way, do you know that Maplewood is on the path of actually getting out of joint powers agreement because they don't want to be in joint powers agreement, but I would support being in joint powers agreement. And it's like they ask the questions on the questionnaires, but in the end, it doesn't matter because the people they endorse are already handpicked before anybody went there and gave the answers.
Didn't Maplewood try to get together a joint powers over a fire training facility?
They did.
Did they succeed?
I don't know. I haven't seen it.
I don't know. And so that's going to be an added expense for the citizens of Maplewood because Maplewood's not bringing in this revenue.
Right.
Because Maplewood took the lead and no one followed.
Yeah.
But they wanted joint powers then.
Yes, that's right.
Okay.
So they... You know, it's an inconsistent policy. And so one of the duties and responsibilities of a council person Certainly, this is what I believe, and if I'm elected, this is the way that I will take it, is that you have to look at what is your consistent policy. If you have a policy that you support joint powers agreements, then you support joint powers agreements because you believe in the underlying philosophy that you can work together with your neighbors to be more efficient in the delivery of services and not have to duplicate efforts that also increases costs to the residents.
Well, and this sounds to me like Maplewood thinking that they can run another business, that they could be successful at running another business, the TV industry, media communication. But my question is, what business has Maplewood been successful at? So like Maplewood Community Center, that's a business, all right?
Yes.
An enterprise zone.
Yeah.
Has lost an average of about $500,000 a year.
Mm-hmm.
So they didn't do well there.
Mm-hmm.
How about the ambulance fund? I think you know more details on
right.
that than I do.
That also is an enterprise fund. And
mm-hmm.
and when we talk about enterprise funds, this is a term that is found within state statute.
Mm-hmm.
Enterprise funds are governed by state statute, how they are to attempt to break even. All of that is all part of what their requirements are in an enterprise fund. And you're not supposed to have an enterprise fund for 20 years that loses money big time. Basically, it's supposed to try to break even. And I think the experiment in many ways has come to a conclusion in Maplewood in that there are some enterprise funds they just have not been successful with, like the community center and the ambulance fund. There are other ones, though, that they've been very successful with. That's because it doesn't involve the providing of service, so to speak. It has to do more with the collection of money.
Okay.
And so the enterprise funds, which are related to the collection of money mandatorily from every single property that is located in Maplewood, those enterprise funds are successful.
Mm-hmm.
Think about the environmental utility tax. Think about the sanitary fee. Think about the recycling fee. See, those are all enterprise funds, and they are all very successful, but they are also all very mandatory that you must participate.
And my understanding on the garbage, though, is that they're using tax revenue to supplement lower rates for garbage
in order to
make them look like they're better than
they were. Well, that's a totally different issue. That, of course, is the garbage collection where they have a contract with Allied Waste. But the recycling, there is a recycling fee,
right,
which is an enterprise fund.
Okay.
And that goes into a dedicated fund that's supposed to go towards, you know, recycling education,
right,
and other kinds of initiatives or whatever. And that's, in the past has had a pretty healthy balance.
Mm-hmm.
Pretty healthy balance.
One more thing before I get to the caller here on how about the solar electric program they have here in Maplewood, where they took a lot of federal money. Took grants, had some Maplewood citizens' expense to build these solar panels.
Mm-hmm.
How are those working out?
Well, you know, I just recently did a data practices request to get some of that information because I really wanted to know how they were working, because I do think it's important that we look at and we invest in alternative energy sources. I really do believe we should. But I think we have to be analytical about it. I think that we have to do, a cost-benefit analysis at some point to decide what type of alternative energy actually works,
right,
for the area you live in.
And it's competitive.
And it's competitive. See, and so I got the data, and I found that for the solar array, that's the solar panels that are on top of the community center, and the solar panels that are in front of City Hall,
right,
that those are treated as two separate locations. But for each location, Maplewood has to pay a sum of $397 per month. It's like a lease payment for this these solar arrays. And originally, it looks like in the paperwork that Maplewood was promised that these arrays would create over $5,000 a year in energy credits from, you know, the energy that was produced as a result of collecting the solar rays from the sun.
Well, $5,000 a year from each panel?
That I don't remember if it was each panel or if it was the two together.
Well, either way.
But I think it was each.
That's $250 a month that they would that was the guarantee.
Yeah.
So at the guarantee level, they would lose $147 a month.
Right. But as it turns out, the one solar array, and if I have my, I hope I have my numbers rather close in the ballpark, that for the particular year that I had, that they gave me the data for, that for the solar array in front of City Hall, that produced energy credits of about $1,400, and then the one on top of the community center was $1,800.
For the year.
For the year. So even if that $5,000 number, mm-hmm. which was estimated, was for the two together, this still didn't meet up to that.
They didn't meet the 5,000 level. They only met, oh, wow.
Yeah, see, so, and there is something in the agreement that says that the company that they were working with as part of this partnership, that they were supposed to pay the difference to Maplewood. I have to further investigate to find out if Maplewood has actually received that difference or not. Because I don't even know if that company is still in business. Because at this business model, I don't know how anybody could stay in business if their agreement then was to make up the difference.
Unless they overcharged, you know, because they got all these government loans and grants. I remember looking at these numbers, but I don't remember the numbers. But we're talking about $300,000 to $500,000 for each panel system.
Yeah.
So that's a lot.
Right. And see,
that's a lot of capital return.
Yeah. And part of this was based upon the fact that there would be then, you know, tax credits that would be generated, not so much for Maplewood, but for this other entity that's helping out with this. But there again, if you don't have those tax credits available and as part of this program to get it started, well, it's just, it's not sustainable. And we hear that word so often about things being sustainable. It's really become an overused word. But what
it means
is it something that can support itself in the long term?
Through revenue.
Because you can have.
Or taxes.
Right, because you can have some programs or initiatives that cost a little more upfront. But as they get going, because of the building blocks they're on and the business model, it's actually something that will, you know, over a length of time, will be okay. But you kind of do that cost-benefit analysis. And I do not hear the current council doing anything with analysis of any topic that comes before them.
It's more, we got money, let's spend it. All right, caller, I'm sorry for keeping you so long. You have a comment or question?
Well, I'm glad you did keep me longer because I liked the information I got from you.
All right, super.
But what I want to talk about is, I'm going to bring a different subject, is AFSCME. Now, that's got to be the most untruthful organization ever in politics, especially Maplewood's politics, because they get people that are ringers for them to run, and then they give untruthful information about them and the public. That's what they see. But they also spread untruthful information about people that are running against their people, and that's the big problem. I have no time for AFSCME whatsoever, and I don't think any citizen Maplewood should have any time for AFSCME either. Thank you.
Well, have you had some history with AFSCME?
Well, I want to thank the caller for, you know, bringing that up. And I do, first of all, want to mention something I think is very important, is that, you know, I know any number of really great people who have been supporters of mine who are Ask Me members, mm-hmm. okay? And it's not about the Ask Me members themselves. It's not about them, because I have had a number of people who have always supported me who are Ask Me members saying, you know, I don't know what my union is doing, but they don't represent me. That they contacted the headquarters to say, why are you doing this? Why are you spending my union dues this way to, you know, enter into a race to say these kinds of things when I don't want my money spent like that, that they are happy that they're part of Ask Me for, you know, the collecting bargaining purposes.
Right.
But then it's the other issue is that when they get interject themselves into political races, you know, are you representing your members, or who are you representing? And that's always a fundamental question. And a couple of years back, there were some political cards that were sent out that contained information that was not accurate. And I felt that it was important to take a stand and to clear my name, because people who know me know that I'm not a shrinking violet. because if there's something that is the right thing to do, it's the right thing to do. And I had a case with Ask Me to challenge their political statements that they made about certain things about Maplewood.
Mm-hmm.
And in the end, because when you're a public official, there's a different, higher standard of whether or not you can claim slander or libel. And so it's really pretty slim if you're a public
right.
figure such as I am to be able to win in a libel or slander or a libel case. However, what we did get out of the case was something else that was just as valuable to me, maybe more so valuable
right.
to me. And that was the judge saying in his order that while, you know, I couldn't succeed on slander or libel, that these were opinions of theirs, and they were entitled to their opinions. So you see, if
even
they're
though
opinions,
they were wrong.
If they're opinions,
yeah.
they're opinions, they're not fact.
Right.
And so to me, that was every bit as valuable, because it was not fact, it was opinion.
Mm-hmm.
And I can deal with people's opinion, but now that's not a fact.
I read one of the pieces that Ask Me put out, and I read it as fact.
Well, it was written to make it sound like fact. That's
yeah.
exactly right. It was written to make it sound like fact.
Right.
Definitely
but
it was.
But in here the judge is saying it was just an opinion.
Right.
But,
that's right.
You know.
Well, I mean, and one of the statements is that basically I couldn't balance a checkbook when I was mayor. Well, the mayor's not in charge of the checkbook, first of all. There isn't a checkbook, and it's a Plan B city.
Right. And so it's the city manager, but there wasn't any problem with the checkbook either.
No, that's right. And, of course, you know, the city manager they were talking about at the time was Mr. Chuck All.
Well, of course you couldn't. You could, yeah, right. Oh, is there an FBI investigation going on, Chuck All?
And this is what was so funny about that is at the time when we're in the middle of this litigation was exactly the time when it was the big headlines in the Pioneer Press about the FBI investigation and how it implicated Mr. Chuck All.
Yeah.
And the judge, I know that it didn't it didn't go past him to realize that we're talking about some of the same names.
Oh, okay.
You never know how things are going to be, you know? You
got
to roll with the punches and have a good humor and good nature about it all.
Yeah. Well, and this gets to the kind of the tax issue. It's kind of the underlying question.
Yes.
But when you were the mayor, you had only one city manager. Now there is...
Well, we Oh, yeah, that's right, at a time, yes.
At a time.
We had more than one city manager, but they were at different times.
Yeah,
that's
okay.
Right, exactly. But yes, only one city manager at a time, right? We never, you know, it wasn't right. That we were looking to have two at a time, which has become the norm since I left office. Once I left office, suddenly they needed two city managers at all times
right.
To run City Hall. Imagine that.
And at four times the expense, you know, I mean, it
possibly could be three times, but yes.
Yeah, three to four times the cost of what it was before.
Yes.
And so taxes, Maplewood, anything that comes across their desk, the city council, everybody is voting for tax increases across the board. I don't see any restraint going
mm-hmm.
on
mm-hmm.
In there. Where are you as far as, you know, balancing a budget,
yeah.
making sure the citizens, the elderly aren't being forced out of their homes,
yeah.
aren't wanting to leave the community that they grew up in.
Right. Well, I feel very strongly that we have to provide good quality essential services, which of course is public safety. Okay, public mm-hmm. safety is priority number one. And whether or not that's police or our ambulance service or fire service, I mean, and public works, those are the essential services. Whether or not we have puppet shows in the park or not, you know, that's a
wow.
a want, not a need. And see, so I think, again, we have a little balancing to do there.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I will say that, you know, when a council member says, well, they're against the cut, against the increases, oftentimes, and you'll hear the city staff say, oh, well, what do you want us to cut? Well, what I did in 2009, because they wanted to do these increases, and I felt that coming, you know, we were still in the throes of the recession, barely coming out of it, that we still had to maintain a flat levy. And so in order to show that it could be done, I actually got the data that I needed from the finance department, and I put together my own budget proposal, and I gave that presentation to the council to show them how we could do it and still stay at the same levy as we were the previous year. And of course, I didn't even get a second. I
wow.
didn't even get a second, but I also voted against their proposal because
mm-hmm.
I knew their proposal was wrong. And so when a proposal is not right, I'm not afraid to fight for what I think is right. I'm not afraid of compromise, but I think that, you know, it takes two to compromise.
Right.
And there was no compromise, and so, you know, I'm not going to succumb and just say, well, I'm going to go along to get along.
Right. Yeah. And that happens right now in our city council.
It does.
People that say they have certain principles, but they just vote against them.
Right.
You know, so
and
big
you know
problem.
And the problem, if it comes up about you know, selling a park or a preserve, I can tell you straight out right here, I'm going to vote no, because I believe that we should not be selling those.
Well, speaking of parks and reserves, we have a rush line corridor, Bruce Ventel Trail.
Mm-hmm.
Excuse me, Bruce Ventel Trail, Gateway corridor, whatever. But they want, right now, the way it's looking, the mayor, current Mayor Norris Lawick, wants that to be turned into a light rail station.
Well, and they're looking, yeah,
and,
I mean, they're.
And pathway.
I mean, one of the easiest routes for them to bring the rush line through Maplewood is right up the Bruce Ventel Trail. And who thought that not only do we have to really fight to protect our parks and preserves, but now we find we got to protect our trails. And I feel very strongly that if we're going to have mass transit, that mass transit should be along transportation corridors like 61, not through the backyards of single-family housing residential. If you want to have economic development to occur because a result of this supposed, you know, metropolitan mass transit, you got to be along commercial corridors. You're not going to be building things in people's backyards. It's
right.
Preposterous.
I ride the light rail, both the blue line and the green line. This going up Bruce Ventel Trail is such a different area.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that's a beautiful trail, when they went through university, when they went down Hiawatha, those weren't trails. Those
no.
were those corridors
right.
Of businesses and connecting people to locations. That trail will not do that and will destroy a treasure in Maplewood.
Right. And also, Maplewood has done all their planning throughout the years that is one of the greenway corridor connections
mm-hmm.
between the other greenways for wildlife migration and the habitat as well.
Mm-hmm.
And so if you start putting other things along the way there, that will actually cut off the animals' habitat and their corridors for
right.
moving through our community.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Well, Diana, thank you for coming on the show. We're about out of time here. When's the election?
November 2nd.
Tuesday, November 2nd.
That's right. And now, of course, you can vote absentee ballot before that date, and you don't need to have a reason. You can just say, you know, I want to make sure I get my vote in because maybe something will happen that day. Well, you can just go and you can fill out an absentee ballot application, send it in, they'll send you a ballot, and vote Diana Longry, Maplewood City Council.
All right, people, thanks for watching. Remember, if you don't stand up for other people's liberties, who's going to stand up for yours? And good men don't do nothing. God bless. Have a great week.
And the wind takes the kite as the firefly brings the light. Said to me that you wouldn't leave, but now I see that you're